Boom.
All right, we're back again. All right, when we were talking about John Farnham, we wrapped John Farnham up.
Johnny Farnham with his mullet.
And but before we went on a break, we had a quick break and we just and we're back again. And while we were on that break, I actually watched the Age of Reason film clip. And it reminded me of, it had a lot of kids running in through the mud. And John Farnham was on an interview once and he said that all the kids were wearing their best clothes. You know, he got like, 50 kids or whatever in the area to run. I don't know where he was. I looked at it. It looked like the Blue Mountains, but it could have been Mount Kosciuszko. It could have been anywhere, but it was somewhere in the... It looked like a winter's day because they were all rugged up, but wearing really nice clothes, all the kids, and they were running through mud, and their parents were upset about them getting all their new Reeboks dirty and stuff because they were in John Farnham's new film clip, So they got their best gear on and completely destroying all of these kids' clothes. It just made me think about the John Farnham. I love doing impersonations, and I don't think there's anybody who's better to impersonate than John Farnham. So can I ask you, all right, if I say John Farnham,
yep,
impersonation, okay, what does John Farnham do with his arms while he's singing?
I don't know. What does he do?
Okay.
Hang on.
That's his big move.
Hang on. Okay. Wait up.
We didn't get that.
I'll just see if I can find a shot. No, he's not doing it. Can he do it for a second? Oh, look, hang on. What's going on down here? Give us a sec. I'll look out.
Oh, he's got an arm up in one.
I just saw him doing a move that was slightly... Oh, there's one there.
Yeah, he loves the clenched fist.
This one. Hey, that's when he was Johnny Farnham.
I kind of like... Yeah, he did have that one, but he really did, to engage the crowd... Like often the crowd wasn't just solely in front of him. Like so often he did the to kind of entertain these guys and then come over to the other side and then like that and that all cheer and then he'd like give a few. So he really had some good body language, Johnny Farnham, and that's how he did his dance. And he often did a point as well. And really sharp moves. John Farnham. Really sharp movie guy. He had your... You were a bit more smooth with your one like this. But John Farnham would sharpen it up. And, so if you put it all together, that was his move. So we go one, two, and three. That's the one, two, three John Farnham move. I just thought I'd get that out there. Well, you can mix it up a bit. You can do that and then do that. That's taken it. I don't know if you can do that. Mix it all up. But, yeah, so that's how John Farnham actually moved as he danced. We had the chance to turn the pages over. So he really, full body movement. The student just walked up to the door and looked at what I was doing there. I don't know, but that one's just for you too, John Farnham fan. So that's John Farnham. I was always really interested in how singers use their body, how they kind of move. Michael Hutchins was actually, he was interesting. He was charismatic on the stage. Terence Trent D'Arby took over the role in INXS, but didn't have that same movement. So Michael Hutchins did a bit of this. And, of course, Peter Garrett, he set the world on fire. He was US forces give the nod. So he was he was all over the place. So Australian rock legends, they really are interesting. But John Farnham with his three-point move, John Farnham three-point move.
The three-pointer.
Yeah, he had point. Yeah, it was first. It was fist. Let's have a listen to that one. And got you on that one. Got you. Yeah, And often with the microphone, he did that as well. Did that. Sang at the AFL Grand Final, John Farnham.
He did.
1988, possibly 88. I'm sure he just sung Waltzing Matilda. Could have sung The Age of Reason. Could have done a bit of Age of Reason. Could have. Not sure, but Michael Hutchins, he's one of the story behind Michael Hutchins is one of the most amazing stories. He was dating an incredible model. I can't think of the name right now. Then also dated our own Kylie Minogue, and then was dating Bob Geldof's wife, Paula Yates.
Oh, I remember and, that. When he was
they had a child. Yeah, no, they had a child.
What happened here? Oh, that's Peter Hall. That's not Hutchins. Oh, yeah. Now, he, there's something about his funeral got, maybe Peter Hall was, yeah, serial pest.
Okay.
Serial pest. Is that an Aussie-ism, serial pest?
It sounds like an Aussie expression.
Which game was this?
Bruce Dool, 1982 Grand Final. Everybody loved Dool. Some people thought that that Helen DeMeca was a she was the inspiration behind the Blues getting over the line. I don't know. Richmond were favourites to win in 82, by the way, and really? They beat us. Yeah, they beat us in the
Helen DeMeca
semi.
DeMeca tries to give Bruce a nude cuddle.
Yeah, I think that I would have given her a cuddle if I was Bruce.
So she got the credit, you're saying that she got a bit of a credit for giving the Blues a bit of a boost?
Well, some people think we had a run on and she might have, because we kicked a goal and she came on and may have taken the momentum, but hey, we went on and won the game.
Oh, so she was actually panned a little bit rather than a scene. Yeah. So, look at Bruce, he's like, come on.
Bruce is like, yeah.
You can't. All righto. No.
There's 110,000 watching. I haven't said a word on TV. I've been in the game. I've played over 300 games. And you want to come running at me nude now? Could you not have waited till after the game? You know, like you know, if Bruce had of, you know, like, man, this is watching too, mate. Come on. It'll get back to her. You know, like, so I don't think, and Jimmy Jess was in the shot there as well, the ghost. And hey, you might be called the ghost, but we can see you wide and clear, right up close to the nudie there, Jimmy.
This is too much here, actually. I better stop this fall. That's a little bit too much skin. Sorry.
Wayne Johnson would actually physically forced her, and that could be looked at as assault.
Really? I guess, I suppose, but they do, I mean, nowadays,
security guards tackle them.
Yeah, they do they do everything they can to bring them to ground. I guess, is it still assault?
The theory behind the security, you know, tackle them to the ground hard is that they're actually like terrorists. They're running onto the ground.
It's an invasion.
They could be, invasion.
If it happened at at the UN, or if it happened with a state, with people with security guards, that they do everything in their power to bring them down. So,
So let's move it forward. Are we going to talk about we've gone through your high school teacher,
Philip Ward.
Philip Ward. We've gone, and that moved on to the data analysis.
Data analysis is a call out to any listeners, any watchers of the Three Rules podcast. If it's called that, that's a working title. We'll see how we go. He was a data analysis teacher. If it's you, sir, I wish I could remember. I don't think I've got it anywhere. See, that's what's amazing with this age of the internet is we can, it'd all be on file somewhere. I could find an email that was sent out, but back then the internet hadn't kicked in. We were offline, so stuff like study guides and and electronic communications were in their infancy. So just trying to find that guy. But he was a data analysis teacher at the University of Southern Queensland around early 90s. He had a dark hair. I think he had a beard. Unleash Your Fearless. Unleash Your Fearless. What about Unleash Your Intrepidness?
Yeah, look, USQ, I'm all good. I'm a graduate from there. But the girl that they've got on there, I don't know if you noticed this, but her eyes are slightly off center.
She's not symmetrical, which is what they've found. Can we talk about that now? That Google engineers, because they're not psychologists, as Peter St. George Pence would say, they don't care. They just go and find out stuff. Where he said in his realm of psychology, that psychologists might think it's an ethical issue what they did. What they did was they researched billions, I think it was, of searches for porn between men and women. And what they found with men was no surprises whatsoever, which was that men go for images and videos of symmetrical women is what they are most attracted to for their porn. Now, with women, they found that they didn't go for pictures and images. They went for literary porn. I think it was called Harlequin. I should probably stop sharing University of Southern Queensland for this topic. Sorry, guys. Anyway, no, there was a thing. There's a reason why. And it was, Where'd you go? She's gone. They've just got rid of her.
It might be on a turning thing where she is.
Symmetrical. So women go for literary pornography. Harlequin is a famous brand. And they went for 6 or 5 archetypes of characters. And basically they went for Beauty and the Beast. If you want to wrap up everything really into one story, it was Beauty and the Beast. I think we'll talk about this. What's the number one book, fastest selling book of all time?
I wouldn't have a clue. What is it?
Got a number in the title.
Oh, 50 Shades of Grey.
50 Shades of Grey, fastest book. It's a cultural phenomenon, that particular book. And that is very typical of these archetypes. And that's Beauty and the Beast. So that was a beastly kind of man. It was a abusive relationship. I haven't read it, but that's what I've heard. Is like there's criticism over how, I think it ends with a love story. I think it ends well. I'm not sure. Anyway, but it was quite a, you know, bondage and sadomasochist kind of relationship where he treated her quite badly. So that's the beastly man that was tamed by the beauty. And then they fell in, and then, you know, spoiler alert. Sorry, guys. Anyway, so the 5 archetypical characters of these beasts were surgeon, billionaire, vampire, werewolf, and pirate. So now we know why Johnny Depp became a superstar with that movie franchise that was based on a Disneyland ride. Did you know that? Pirates of the Caribbean?
Was that first a Disney ride and then turned into a movie first?
It was based on a ride at Disneyland. Oh, Disney World. Okay. Disneyland, the one in LA. So that's quite amazing. That was the premise of that whole franchise, which blew up. And reason being, perhaps, is because he was seen as a massive sex symbol or a sexual character, Jack Sparrow, which I didn't think of at all till I learned this about these Google engineers.
He's got a really interesting voice, Jack Sparrow. I think you've got to think, it's not only the costume that he's put together, it's also the way he presents himself, his voice. I'm Captain Jack Sparrow. Do you know, because there's guys who did the Jack Sparrow character, you know, like 50 years ago, you know, like in the old black and white days when in the old Hollywood productions where MGM would have a lion, rawr, rawr, and then Captain Jack Sparrow, rawr, like, yeah, my hearties. Like, where did they get the language and where was this vocabulary? Like, did pirates actually call their friends my hearties? Hello, my hearties.
Arr, hearties.
And did they, like when they got their drinks out, I'm sure they had really bad dentistry, so they didn't pop the cork for their teeth. I'm sure they just went, look, could you open this for me? Because it's really hard to open with my sore teeth. You know, like could you open that for me? Thanks.
My good chap.
Yeah, would you like a glass? Arr, my hearty. Would you like a glass, my hearty? I'm going to have one myself. Do you mind? Like, I'm sure that's how a pirate would really act. You know, they wouldn't be rough with their mates. Do you know, like, as if they're going to say arr, to their mate. Do you know what I mean? I'm sure they're going to be like, would you open that for me? Good. Would you like a glass too, mate? You know, I'm going to have one for myself. I'll have one too. And then bang them down. And then once they got them in, then they started their anyway. Interesting. Yeah, the Pirates of the Caribbean. He did that one. And I thought that he did What's Eating Gilbert Grape.
Yes, he did. I'm pretty sure.
And And Leonardo DiCaprio played a teenage boy who was a bit of a simpleton. And it was his younger brother, I think. And he was like a protective older brother. And anyway, his role in that was delivering groceries. He was a grocery delivery boy. So he really has come a long way from those times. You know, he did 21 Jump Street. What's it? Eating Gilbert Grape.
Oh, yeah.
And then he turned. Jump
Street. That's where I liked
first
him.
First come across.
I was like, Johnny Depp, I'm a big fan from his 21 Jump Street days.
Yeah, and so he's a, and then he seemed to be a bit of a, like a kind of an edgy character, you know, like he could play a criminal, he could play a good guy, bad guy, he could do from Willy Wonka to,
you know. Opposite of typecast, isn't he? Really did go on the edgy, like working with Tim Burton. Eating Gilbert Grape. Got very good rating, 7.8 out of 10 with the IMDb. Rotten Tomatoes, 89, 90% liked it. I have not seen it.
Yeah, well, it's a, he plays an interesting role where he has an affair with an older lady. Now, that's not part of our thing, but we've got here in our second question, have we moved on? Have we addressed, because we didn't touch Jordan Peterson and we didn't touch...
Peterson, we've done the USQ. If data analysis side, if you're there, if anybody knows, please,
yep.
I'd love to at least get his name, if not get him on. It'd be great to see what he's doing now. And he was such a big influence. We did one thing was Little River Band reminiscing. Do we want to have a listen to the Little River
Band? Do we want to go walking through the park,
walking
dancing in the dark and reminiscing? I can hardly wait. Here we go. Oh, he had a cup of tea. They even had time for a cup of tea with the cello and the cup of tea. And a cat. And a degree. He sung at the grand final too.
I remember that. Is that a mullet?
Do you know what? I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt. I think that's before mullets because 1978, the mullet wasn't quite in. I think that's a 1978 blow wave.
Blow wave. Laugh down. Man. Oh, yeah.
That's the way it began. Glenn Miller's band was playing. We were better than before. We yelled and screamed. And the It ended all too soon.
Spoiler alert.
All right, interesting. Look, I love the clothes they're wearing. The actual lounge room, the carpet, the lounge suites.
It looks like the sports club I went to in Black Rock, Sandringham, the Sandringham Club.
Okay.
It looks like that right now.
I would love to have gone to the Sandringham Club.
Let's go there next time, mate.
Yeah,
let's do it. I went to play poker there and I went all in and I was all out.
But that's sometimes better to go out big than to dwindle all of it away.
I could have. What I should have done is not bet everything. I should have just bet if I wanted to intimidate but still have some in the bank. It was just now I think back, I'm like, what was I doing? But I'm not a great poker player, but I've done that before. It was what have you been doing? You know, it was a rush of blood and it was a big bluff. And I did it. See, it was the second time I did it. Don't do it twice. You get away with it once. If you do it twice,
two bluffs.
Like, we might be taking me, especially if you've got a good hand and I got done.
Yeah.
Should we move on from reminiscing? Can we say goodbye to the Liver River Band?
We can say goodbye to the Liver River Band, but I just want to say, not forgotten, we will always have a special place for Glenn Sharrock and his Little River Band. They actually made it commercially overseas as well. They were quite big. They were one of Australia's most successful international acts.
Yeah, right. So yeah. They broke out.
They broke out. Like, I mean, he looks a little bit like Max Walker, but he's not, I don't think. But
Maxie, I think there's mullets in there, mate. Or is it? No, it's different, isn't it?
1978 was before a mullet. I think mullets.
See where they came from, though. Look.
Yeah.
This is the genesis, I dare say.
See, it was fluffy. It was this.
It was very fluffy.
It was that.
Did you ever have those ones?
I specialised in that till I was till I had my own proper mullet, and then from the proper mullet that lasted until 1989, and then I cut my mullet off in year 12, and I played football, and I remember like 1988 it was I cut my mullet off. It was 1988. No, 1989. I cut my mullet off. 88. I was full mullet, and it was. Part of me was disappointed. I was like, "Oh, I shouldn't." But Kylie Minogue and Jason Donovan, like their hairstyles had just started changing. He may have actually got rid of his mullet at that stage.
Did he start mullet and then went short?
Yeah, he went mullet. And so once he went short, the lifespan of a mullet, like the time had gone, like the era had passed and it was time to get rid of it. It was more impact. Going to school with a bit of impact, not having a mullet was like, ooh, this is a statement, no mullet. And you had to have a statement. Year 12, you had to do a statement. You had to come with colour in your hair or you had to do... You had to change the flip or the, you know, you had to put gel or something in it. There had to be a statement, you know, everyone did. If you didn't, you missed out. But that's the point we're going to go into now is our 18-year-old self. Now, year 12 is kind of 17.
18-year-old, hang on. Apologies there.
All right, so we were talking about your 18-year-old self, like going back and talking to yourself as an 18-year-old and, you know, what you would do different. Now, we mentioned earlier about being a person Friday, not girl Friday, not boy Friday, but person Friday being PC. And we talked about being in the classroom a little bit as well, you know, and just about doing those kind of jobs and so on. Now, put yourself in the... As an 18-year-old, first before we go there, as an 18-year-old, where were you? What were you doing in your life? Were you at school, or what was the deal? I guess first year uni would be where you were at, or what were you doing as an 18-year-old? Were you playing sport, and you know, were you involved in anything that's worth mentioning?
Yeah, 18. I turned 18 in grade 12. I moved up from Victoria to Queensland, and I was young. I was always younger than my classmates in Victoria, because I started school when I think when I was 5 instead of 6, I think. I'm not sure. Anyway, I was always the baby of the class. Then when I moved to Queensland, I wasn't doing that great at school. My parents divorced, and I think it was part of it, and I started to slip a little bit. It was tough. Got to move to high school. I'd done grade 7 was high school in Melbourne, in Victoria. And then I was starting grade 8. So I'd done 2 years of high school and I wasn't doing that well. We'd move to Collingwood and stuff. Anyway, so when I went to Queensland and when I was 18, so then I repeated. But it was really cool because we moved in September. So it was coming close to the end of the year. So instead of me going into grade 8 and then repeating, Dad said, why don't we just put you in grade 7? Because no one will know. Just put you in grade 7. And then you can and it was like one term to go. And then you can naturally go into grade 8 next year. No one's the wiser. I went, that's a great idea. And it was interesting because what happened is I went in Queensland, grade 7 is primary school still. So I went from my second year, almost finishing my second year of high school, to go back into primary school. So I was really confident. And also I went from all boys school, which I'd been in since Montessori, since very early primary school, into a co-ed state school in the countryside, in Logan Reserve, which was a rural urban fringe. It was surrounded by horse and cattle farms, I think, really. It was lots and lots of land. So, yeah, I went from city slicker to country bumpkin high school, urban high school in East St Kilda to countryside state school, an old Queenslander with a board house. And it was good. It was great. I was there and I was playing sport. Sorry, I know this is meant to be 18 when I'm 18. But when I went there, it was cricket season. It was just starting. It was the last term. And they made me skipper of the cricket team. I was quite skillful. So that was really good too. That was a boost for the confidence too. And had my first kiss and my first girlfriend. Anyway, so great. 18, I was moving on to – I was at boarding school and I turned 18 in August of grade 12. So I was a mature. Most people turned 18, I think, the next year. I don't think many people were turning 18 in high school, in grade 12. I think they turn 18 in the year after. I'm not sure. Anyway, so I was I was a bit older than most people, and 18. I was still in high school. Yes, I was playing rugby, playing cricket. I had a crack. Did I have a crack at rowing? I had a bit of a crack at rowing. We were a very strong rowing school. But I did not have the aptitude of it. Was not great. And all the fitness. But yeah, cricket, rugby, I was at school. And then, I went to university in Warwick. I did an alternative entry into USQ at Warwick Sophia College. There was one in Harvey Bay and Warwick. So I wasn't supposed to go to university. I didn't matriculate. I did a business course, which was designed for the rural sons of farmer fathers who would send them to the boarding school on the Gold Coast there. And then we got trained up in business, which held me in good stead. But yeah, I remember finishing school going, what am I going to do now? Anyway, I tried to go to an early bird program and they said, no, this isn't for you, mate. This is for the elites who are wanting to get a quick start and start their university in their Christmas holidays rather than wait till February. this isn't something. And then they told me about Hervey Bay and Warwick, and I went, okay, I'll go for that. They said, this alternative entry. So I got into there, got accepted, and it was good. It was kind of halfway, it was, again, boarding school, so it was halfway between university and school. But that was co-ed, so it was good. It was a good, we got coached, and we did three subjects which didn't go towards our degrees. It was study skills, which is good. It was a good sort of like life and time and stress management, communication studies, and I think a maths course, I think. So these ones we had to do, but they weren't credit. We didn't get credited for them. And we had to pass, I think we had to pass three out of six subjects or four out of six subjects to get accepted into USQ the next year. So that was my 18-year-old. Actually, I think I was playing rugby for Warwick, and I think I was vice captain at one stage. And I came runner-up for best and fairest. Well, we were a pretty poor team, but I could kick the ball. So they had me at number 10. Which was quite a skillful, was very skillful position. I didn't have really the great skills. I scored a couple of tries, but we had a pretty poor team, and I'd get smashed a lot. They'd give me the ball and I'd kick it a lot. We played a lot like England, and we actually wore England jersey. We had the white with the rose, and we played a very English style of football, which was give it to me and I'd boot it. And we're often in not real great field position, but when we were in great field position, I'd have a crack, but that wasn't rare. We didn't win many games that year. But yeah, that was my 18. So that's where I was. Was that a two-part question? Advice I'd give myself? That's the background, and then what advice?
Yeah, so if you were to give yourself advice, of course, there's the make sure that you do the letters. Make sure you put the letters in there. Make sure you do
that,
which makes me think I should mention as well that when your first job, you're not going in as CEO. A lot of people think that when they finish uni that the world has got to owe them something because they've achieved this, so they're going into the big, they've got to get the big bucks, and they've got to get everything happening straight away.
I had that a little bit.
And yeah, just make. You're not going to be that. You know what you're going to be? You're going to be serving. You're going to be a servant within a company at some level. And don't be surprised if you're, even if you have to do something like go to your local swimming pool and teach kids to swim.
Oh,
or if you have to do, yeah. Or if you have to go to a company and even work voluntary for 6 months.
Yeah.
If there's no work around.
That's a good one.
Just don't go to the unemployment office and don't go to the unemployment office and pick up a dole check and sit on that for 2 years while you get your confidence together to be able to do
something. It's a waste of time, isn't it? I look back and where I've had time where I go, Jesus, I had so much energy. When you're young, you've just got so much energy. So you can do that. You can volunteer with hope to get a gig or do something else, and you can do so much. That's one of the things.
And the other thing I recommend is, and I think you mentioned this. You did. Was this right? That I wished I'd done this, and you were mentioning it the other day that you did a bar course and you learned how to do drinks.
Yep.
So if you're going to be a socialite and you're going to go to bars and you're going to do all that sort of stuff, learn the craft of the bars, learn the bar scene, and get to become sort of acquainted with alcohol and understand how it mixes, what the effects are of all different alcohols. Learn the people who work in bars, what type of bars there are, so that when you go to bars, you don't just go in and start a fight with some guy. Unknowingly, you just get drunk and you bump into somebody and find yourself with a big black eye, and you don't have enough confidence to people then say, oh, I don't really like going out to bars so much. Well, nobody likes getting a big black eye. Nobody likes bumping into the wrong person and being in the wrong places. So learn a little bit about the drinks, learn a little bit about the dynamics of the nightlife, because you may end up meeting, you may meet you know, you may meet friends through your social life. So what kind of friends you make might be just because that's the bar you went to. Whereas if you learn a little bit about nightlife and you thought, wait a second, that's not really my scene, but I enjoy this wine, you know, like we go wine, you know, really good wine selection here. Next thing you know, you're talking to the president's daughter, you're talking about wine, you know, if you're an 18-year-old, you know, and that's the president asks you to go for a game of golf, you know, you're surrounded by different types of people. You're not necessarily, you want to do things, whatever it is you do, you want to do things that could lead on to building your confidence, to get your career started and get you going in the right direction.
Gary Vee talks about that. He says, because he gets a lot of people, oh, be my mentor, or what advice have you? He gives a lot of advice to young people, especially people just coming out of uni or just about to go to uni. And he says, give it away. Look, do exactly what you're saying. Volunteer and get as close to that person you want to be. So if it's that boss, just get as close to whatever it is, whether it's, if you're a creative person, get close to that creative director or that, the guy shooting, whatever it is, and just learn from it. And even if you do give that time away, I just want to ask you, because I found this now, and now I look back and go, whoa, I had no idea how hard this is. Did you look at your managers sometimes as a kid, as a 20 something, and go, geez, they got an easy gig. I could do that heaps better than them.
Yeah, good question. Yeah. Well, you know, when I was about 28, I realized that you don't need to be a rocket scientist to be a manager. I worked that out, and I worked out that most managers don't actually know what they're doing. They're just making it up as they go. They don't have, it's, you know, you have this idea that your manager is some guy who knows everything. And I also, but it wasn't until recently that I actually worked out that if you say to a manager, like if they come at you, attack you, you can actually attack them back. People say, nah, say nothing, just do this and do that. But you can actually say, mate, you really don't know what you're doing. You really don't know what you're doing. If you don't get angry, you can say anything you want to them. Mm-hmm. You can say, look, if they've got the power to sack you, then don't. But if you work out that your boss, the guy who's your manager, if they're giving you a hard time and they don't have the power to sack you, you can just say exactly what you want. Honestly, you can say absolutely anything you want to them if you don't use bad language and it's the truth. And if that makes you feel better, great. Just let it rip. I think I held in too many things where I was like, oh, let me just hold this in. If I say it, it'll feel good. Yeah. It'll feel good and you know, I'll regret saying it or something. But what you do is this is the thing, right? If you're going to say it, you do not stop. You do not stop and you hold it and you bang them in the eye and you let them know that you are quintessentially do not deserve to be in that role and I'm coming after your role and I'm taking your job. So just expect me to come at you because you really are bad. And do you know what? Yeah, and you just bang him in the eye and you tell him that and you say, look, I'm going to go and if there's somebody who has the power, just tell them that you really don't deserve that job. And, hey, I know that and you know that. And so let's just cut to the chase. You're only in there because somebody just made a mistake and that's why you're in there.
Do you reckon that's good advice? I'm coming for your job.
I really would have liked to have done that. I really would have liked to have done that.
Well, I don't know if that's a good move.
I did the opposite. Same. I did the exact opposite, same. Right? What I did was I just copped smarty pants. I copped it and I didn't say anything. And I think he actually quit. You know, I think he quit his job. So I spoke to a guy who was a diplomat, and his advice, because he was working with us at this time.
Okay.
And he said to me, he's only going to last there 3 years.
Yep.
Clearly, he's not that good at his job.
Yep.
You know that. I know that, and I'm pretty sure everybody above knows that, and everybody can see what's going on here. So you've got two options. You could even see, but this is the thing, right? When you this comes with a clause, like everything, right? Don't do it in front of anyone.
Good point.
Don't do it in front of anyone. If anyone else hears it, then he's got to back it up, and he's got to do something about it. But if you're just the two of them, mate, you can just whisper in his ear how bad he is and how crap he is and how you don't deserve to be there. And guess what? I'm going to take your job. And when I do, just know that when you leave here, leave, okay, and know that you shouldn't have ever come here. So just leave quietly.
That's brutal.
You know, like bang. And when you do that, you know, it's kind of like being a footballer.
Yeah, well, if you're playing in that sphere, it's good. I'll give you an example of what I saw. This actually happened. So I was at at work, and I was similar to you. Like I not that I didn't stand up for myself, but it was a new manager. He went from our level to like assistant managers. They open up these positions, and like you see, I'm sure you've seen it so many times. These new managers, they don't know what they're doing. They go on a power trip, and it's not that they're trying to wield power. They just don't what it is that I've learned, and I'm glad someone told me about it. Was they're fearful that people aren't listening to them, so they go over the top with the austerity, you know, the sort of too much, and you're like, whoa, dude, fuck, chill out. Where the good managers are really calm, you know, and they're just like, hey, going good, you know, as you see that with the. So that's what I find these guys that, and it comes from fear. It comes from, I don't know what I'm doing, and I know that I'm not what I'm doing, so I'm going to be more hardcore. And the other, it's funny because the hard manager, the experienced managers like it. Because then they go, oh, sweet, yeah, you be the prick. I'm just going to... So they don't stamp it out because it makes their job easier, which perpetuates the problem. And I saw it at many different places like Nova that we worked together. Anyway, what happened was it was very...
Mate, yeah, mate.
All right, sorry, so, no. Hang on a minute. Yeah.